So let's start off on the description of the study design. So this is the start of the template here in the table of contents, and you can see it. This one actually asks for a statement of a schematic of the study design. That is something that we haven't seen in all previous protocol templates, but it's a really helpful way to get a visual of what's happening in the study. Where do participants go? What different study arms might they go into? What steps are involved in terms of number of study visits and those types of things? So that's something that there's instructions in the template for. So one of the key elements that you want to talk and have fully described in your protocol is the description of the study. And I have two different examples here. The first is an observational study of decline in pulmonary function in persons living in heavily industrialized areas compared to persons in non-industrialized areas. And the second is a prospective non-concurrent study of post-operative pneumonia in patients receiving regional versus general anesthesia for peripheral vascular grafting. So there's a lot of words in each of these descriptions, right? But what they're trying to convey as succinctly as possible is the study observational, or is it doing an intervention, asking people to either take a medication, get a treatment, attend group visits, you know, where something actually the participant does or something is done to the participant. So that's one aspect. The other aspect is whether it's prospective or retrospective. So are you gathering new information on people you enroll in the study, or are you going back through old records retrospectively and pulling information on them? Is the study randomized or not? In this case, neither of these studies are randomized. They're both observational cohort study designs where some of the participants are exposed to a particular risk factor and others are exposed to either not to that risk factor or to some other version of an intervention. There's some information here about the patient population as to who they are. So, looking at decline, the other aspect is that the actual outcome measure. So the first one, the outcome measure, is pulmonary function, right? We're looking at decline in pulmonary function, specifically in these people who live either in one area, the heavily industrialized area, which is the risk factor that the cohort study is looking at, versus those that live in a non-industrial area. We can't randomize people to either live in one area or to not live in that area. So we have to do observational studies for this kind of work. The second one is also prospective. It's also observational. And in this case, they're looking at a very specific patient population that's either getting one of two different types of anesthesia for this peripheral vascular grafting procedure. And the question is, how much postoperative pneumonia do you see in those patients? So the unique word here is non-concurrent, which means there's been a change in practice. So people used to receive general anesthesia for this procedure. Now they're receiving a more regional anesthesia. And these investigators were interested, are there better outcomes with a regional versus a general anesthesia? There's good reason to suggest so, but because they're not done at the same time and patients aren't randomized to receive one or the other, there's a lot of potential bias that could have happened in this type of study because a lot of other things could have changed in practice as well, in addition to the fact of how we deliver anesthesia. So all of those are different elements that you want to think about when you're describing your actual study, and I'm going to go into a little bit more detail. So whenever you're describing your study design, the most important thing to focus on, and what I often, in talking to investigators that are thinking about submitting applications, what I always come back to is, what is the question of interest? What is the hypothesis that you want to test? Do you want to see whether an intervention now works in a new population? Do you want to make a decision about an individual case and be able to make maybe predictive responses about who will respond to one treatment versus another? Do we want to look at overall change in a population? Do we want to look at differences between one group versus another, a comparative effectiveness study, drug A versus drug B, treatment A versus treatment B, procedure A versus procedure B? Are there biomarkers or are there outcomes that we're very interested in looking at? And then one of the aspects of looking at all of this is what's currently known and doing a critical evaluation of what's currently known to determine where do we go next. So if we have no safety data on, in our center, we work, we have applications looking at botanicals or dietary supplements or probiotics. If we have no safety data on a particular natural product, it's really unlikely we would be able to initially jump straight to does it work for a given condition. We're likely going to need to do some earlier safety types of studies. So our question of interest, well, in the end might be does it work? We may need to do some earlier steps to figure out how safe is it, how high of a dose can we do, and those sorts of pieces. And so our question changes based on what the current level of evidence is. So I think you've heard quite a bit about different designs and different types of options. And so it's important to think through as you're trying to decide what you're going to propose and the kind of study that you're going to do, what is your hypothesis that you want to test, and then what's the best design out of all the different options that are out there to answer that hypothesis. And so what we often challenge investigators to think about is, well, we all usually care the most about does it work, which is the answer to the efficacy or the phase three clinical trial sort of question. There's often a lot of other information we need to gather before we're ready to know and do the study about does it work or not. So really think through what's the current level of evidence and where you're at. And the design is really completely based on the hypothesis that you want to test. And I'll talk a little bit about more about that in a little bit. So the next kind of critical element that's in your protocol is, well, who do you enroll? Who's going to participate in your given study? And what information do we need to collect about these individuals? So in your protocol, you want to have a lot of information about how your staff or how your investigators are going to find and recruit participants. They are not going to magically knock on your door. You have to, are you going to advertise? Are you going to use social media? Are you going to recruit through letters sent by their physicians? Are you going to recruit by identifying potential participants that are eligible through their electronic health records? Are you going to solicit for healthy volunteers because that's the patient population that you need? You need to figure all of those details out. Where are you going to advertise? You know, if you're looking for a patient population over the age of 65, a children's network publication or social media is probably not the best place to look for those individuals. You might want to go somewhere else. So getting a lot of information on the demographics of who these people that are offering you different marketing opportunities, what their demographics are, who are the kind of people that they can reach out to, what's their circulation, how many people do they talk to. We're finding more and more that people are using social media to recruit participants, and that seems to be working quite well, although the initial screening process creates a very wide funnel at the top, which can be very resource heavy, depending on how your study is set up and how much initial screening can happen online versus needing to be done in person. One of the things that you'll need to think through is how will you document different aspects? So how many people did express interest in the study? If you think about a consort diagram that we see in most clinical trials when they're published, they talk about how many people were screened, how many people were eligible, how many people were ineligible, why were they ineligible? Did they decide they were just no longer interested in the study, or they actually met an ineligibility criteria? They were met an exclusion criteria. So all of these are things that if you don't know up front how you're going to collect that information, you're never going to be able to complete that diagram that's required for many of the publications and for many of the journals to be able to describe what happened to your participants. We'll talk a little bit more later about the consent procedure and what needs to be in the protocol for that, as well as the randomization if that's applicable. So the challenge with detailing your inclusion and exclusion criteria is that it's a balance. So when you think about this, think about the hypothesis you want to test and what's really the patient population that you should be testing that hypothesis in. So if you want to know whether a mindfulness-based stress reduction program helps patients with depression, do you really want patients who have failed six medications that are considered, the term is treatment resistant, they've been non-responsive to medications? What if your entire population of people that you enroll in your study are all of these treatment resistant folks that none of the medications or the multiple classes of medications have been beneficial for them? Will that make your study more or less likely to find an outcome? Is something like mindfulness-based stress reduction likely to help that particular population? So you really need to think through, who is it that I'm looking for to participate? The inclusion criteria, think about who's in. What different kinds of elements do we need to define to decide who is going to be into the study? So they often, you want them to have the condition that you are interested in studying. So if it's chronic low back pain, you want to define for how long do they have to have chronic low back pain. What do we mean by chronic? Is that a month? Is that 2 months? Is that 3 months? And there's, I'm going to show you some examples of some definitions that you can use to help you so that you don't have to create that de novo for every study that you do. You want some demographic characteristics. Are you going to limit your study to only men or only women? Is there a scientific rationale for doing that? Is there a specific age range that you want to recruit? Because, for example, no one has looked at the treatment of low back pain in older adults over the age of 65. All of the previous studies have only been done under the age of 65. So maybe that's a population we need to figure out what works for and need to target that group specifically. And then if there's any specific elements, if, for example, you're recruiting patients with diabetes, is there a specific hemoglobin A1C level that they have to have on a baseline screening? Are there other laboratory results or diagnostic tests that they need to meet in order to be the patients that you want to study in your trial? We often see the ability to understand and comply with procedures in the study. You want your participants to actually be able to do the different aspects that they're going to be required to do. And if your study instruments may only be available in English or in Spanish, do you have someone that can translate? Is the instrument valid if it's been translated? Those are issues that you need to think about as well. Now, the exclusion criteria, I cannot tell you how often I get a call from an investigator who is struggling with recruitment because, lo and behold, the exclusion criteria is excluding participants that might otherwise be eligible for the study. It's shocking. I know that people who meet an exclusion criteria cannot participate in the study. And I think I'm doing my best to make a bit of a joke about this, but it's so frequent a request to loosen the strictness of the exclusion criteria because recruitment is not going as well as we thought it was going to. And so I really urge you to think very carefully about this balance between studying the right population, but making it loose enough that it actually generalizes to who is in the real world and might actually be using these interventions that you're studying, and really basing your set of inclusion and exclusion criteria around the scientific aspects of who should be in the study and who should be studied, who's the best population to answer your hypothesis, as well as the safety aspects of making sure you exclude anyone that it wouldn't be ethical or it wouldn't be safe to include them in the study, that they really need other treatment. So we often see that patients with unmanaged severe mental health conditions are excluded, and that's really because we want to make sure that they get referred to treatment of those conditions and that they're not delayed from being treated for those very serious conditions while they participate in a study. And so that's really the safety aspect of those pieces. So you really kind of want to go through and make it very clear. And I'm starting to think more and more about asking my investigators to give me their first pass at how they would change their inclusion and exclusion criteria if recruitment were slow, to get them to really think about what this should be so that they can realistically hit their target goals. Because the almost always the most difficult aspect about any clinical trial is finding enough participants that meet your inclusion exclusion criteria and that want to do your study. And so it's just the common challenge that we're seeing across all studies. So I think the other elements you can read here, I think I mentioned the safety piece. Pregnancy is often a common exclusion criteria that we see, particularly for novel medications, for drug studies, for natural product studies, where we don't know what the impact of those would be on a developing fetus. There is still a huge need for studies in pregnant women to determine how they can be treated for many medical conditions. And because they're excluded for safety reasons from most trials, there's usually very little data about the safety and effectiveness of most treatments in pregnant women. And so it is a, typically those are done as specialty trials that focus only on that patient population. There are many women who need to continue their medications or continue their other treatments, and it would cause safety concerns for the mom to be able to get off of those. And so they do continue to use them despite not knowing what the impact may be. So there is definitely still a need for that. However, for the general population studies, we often do see those exclusions, and those are generally considered scientifically acceptable exclusions. Because in a general study, you wouldn't have enough pregnant women participating to be able to inform anything about safety if you only have three or four individuals in a study who are pregnant. The other important thing to think about are the logistic concerns. You don't want to enroll patients, for example, that need to come to a class that happens every Tuesday night from 7 to 8 p.m. when they have a conflict. There are some things that you can include in your inclusion and exclusion criteria to make sure that they're not expecting to move. If you're studying active military or those National Guard, that they're not anticipating a deployment, such that they would be gone and not able to complete the study, and you would have a large amount of missing data because of that. There are some unique ways of doing trials in those populations so that you can get complete data, but it is a kind of a specialty place. So I think I'll conclude that with it's a careful balance between you want to be specific enough to get the right patient population, but not too restrictive that you can't find any of those people when it comes to inclusion and exclusion criteria. So it really is a difficult balance, and spend a lot of time really thinking about those elements, because that is what makes or breaks your ability to recruit and complete a trial.